Hi there. I was preparing another video about aircraft parts, and I went in my attic and found an old box filled with totally broken aircraft instruments from the good old days. They are mostly from the 1950s, around that. They have seen better days, of course. Some get smashed. Some had some water inside, moisture. Well, that's more than moisture. They almost have been drowned somewhere. And that box is the autopilot switch from a DC-7. Also an airplane from the 1950s, and I'm going to take them apart because I probably can use some of the parts inside. Well, let's see what's inside. Let's start with this box. I don't expect there is too much interesting inside because these boxes normally just have a switch and a couple of lamps and some wires inside, but you never know. You can see it's relatively crusty. It's all oxidized here. It's the SP20 gyropilot selector switch. Can see that here. If you want to Google these numbers, maybe you can find something, but remember, this stuff is old and the internet was not invented then. But some of these parts were in service for a very long time. Okay, it's a little bit more inside. I thought we have here something that looks like a transformer. It is rated from minus 55 degrees centigrade to plus 85. Maybe it's not a transformer. It says 26.5 volt DC. Maybe it's some sort of relay. We have a diode, a semiconductor, which is almost a sensation in an old part like that. And we have something that looks like a fuse, but it's more like a confuse because I'm a bit confused. Like, it is broken, the glass is shattered. Let's see if I can take it out in one piece. No, that's not possible anymore. Ooh, I think someone has thrown this around like crazy. Ooh. The wire is still intact. Oh yeah, it's corroded. So maybe that broke the glass. There was something, so that's the wire. That's okay. I think that was some sort of a bimetal switch. Maybe, maybe not. Ooh, what is it? Oh, okay. Aha. Let's have to cut the wire. Where is my cutter? Here. So I think I know what this is because Okay, that's not the right side. It says it is a... where is it? Come on, focus. It's a tung saw flasher. So I think that's a device that makes something flash. Let's see if that makes any sense. We have an orange wire that doesn't go to that. There is a no, not really. But I think that's some sort of bimetal flashing switch, or well, yeah, how can we call that? That's something that was also used in cars in the early day. It's a bimetal, it heats up, it opens a contact, then it cools down, closes the contact, heats up again, and repeats that cycle and flashes. So obviously we have here this bimetal part, which is totally rusty. Rusty and crusty. Okay, let's get rid of the glass. Yeah, something like that. So something on that box was flashing. Maybe that here, that's a light socket. What's missing here is an orange cap with the light bulb underneath. This one is a panel illumination, also like this one to illuminate the writings on the panel for flying the night. Normally you can screw them off. Normally. Okay, that one doesn't screw off anymore. The whole light socket here is turning around. It works like this. The plate here is made of plexiglass. It's black painted. And the light here shines into the side of this hole, which is unpainted. It's just dirty right now. And then the light distributes inside the panel, and all the letters here, they are a little bit engraved into this black paint and then laid out white, and the light shines through this, through the letters, and you can read it in the night. I cleaned it a little bit to show you what I mean. If you look at this, here is the paint is off in this corner, so I take a little torch. And you can see, for example, these scratches, how they light up. So everywhere where the black paint is removed, the light comes through. Also, maybe if I will clean this a little bit more, you can see it. Yeah, I think you get the idea how this works. So I was able to remove this screw on this side here and take the panel out with the light inside. And you can see here, it's the date, 1958, March 11. That's the birthday of this panel. It's made by Sperry gyroscope. What US radio means, I have no idea. I'm pretty sure there is no radium inside this panel or inside this box. But what is quite fascinating is that the red light here is still working. You can see it on the side where the paint is scraped off. You can see it here where the scratches are. Oops, no more power. So after all that time, this light bulb is still working. Well, maybe it's not the first light bulb, maybe it has been replaced a couple of times, but when I look at the state, rusty, corroded, still working. That's quality. I'm surprised how well this screws are still working. I think they are all stainless. Looks like that. So, okay, there's another one. Also, there's no rust on it. What is this? Okay, I will cut some wires off here. I'm sorry, but this unit will definitively never work again. It's not my fault. Oh, there is a part of a schematic diagram. Oh yeah, it looks like we have some sort of relay. You can see half the circle which corresponds to the contacts here. You see some switches and in the middle something that looks like a resistor, which is most likely the relay coil. Let's see if we could figure that out. It's a pretty special form of a relay, a round relay with the contacts all around, like a rotary switch. Is there a marking? I think there are a couple of numbers. We have, no, that's more like scratches. There is a number 40. I don't know. Let's see if we can find out. Well, it seems I found the relay coil. It says 26.5 volt. I have 24 volts. That should be okay. And it's clicking. Incredible. Well, it's not that incredible, because if you look at the contacts here, they are all sealed, they're airtight, watertight, everything here around that's sealed, it's probably a soldered strip of copper foil, here also sealed, so this thing would even work underwater. Okay, that's the first surprise here. I think we don't have any more surprises inside this box. So let's go to another one. And for those who want to see the diode, it's here. It says something like O3SF, and there are a couple more. It's difficult. 212. And I think the more I scrape here, the more of the letters disappear. So maybe if you want, you find something about this, I think you most likely won't. That's the indicator light socket. It is a press to test socket. That means if you push on the transparent cover here, the lamp will light up to test the lamp. In the days before LEDs, that was important, and even with the LEDs, there is the AN, American Army, Navy, Air Force, something number of this, United States, made for the government. And just in case, in a more modern catalog here, you see they are still produced. They look a little bit shorter here, but that's the sort of cap that goes on it. You can still buy them from Dialight. Still in business after 60 years or even more. What I have here is a ILS instrument, instrument landing system. This is used to find the runway if you are relatively close to it. So airports, they have transmitters that send electromagnetic signals into the direction where the airplane will come from. There is a vertical signal and a horizontal signal, and this is indicated by the two needles here. Sorry for the broken glass, we will remove that a little bit later. So the goal is to adjust the direction of your airplane so that the two needles cross exactly in the middle here where this little circle is. Then you are on the right direction and you have for the correct height. This means it's a 3-degree slope to the runway where you are flying to. The signals work more or less like that. There are two different sets of antennas for the vertical and for the horizontal part of it. These antennas send for the direction, for the horizontal part, right, left or right, they send two tones. One is, let me see, one is 90 and the other is 150 hertz. If you are in the center of this beam, you will receive both signals in the same amplitude, and the needle here stays in the middle. If you go to one side, you will have more from the 90 and 150. You have more 19 hertz, more amplitude of that signal, so the pointer here goes to one side. If you have more of the 150 hertz signal, the pointer goes to the other side. So this makes it possible to find the center to the beginning of the runway. Here on the corner we have a light which is missing now, the light bulb and also the blue cap. The blue light is the outer marker. That means that's another transmitter which is located 4 nautical miles before the runway, A nautical mile is 1,800 meters, while a normal mile is 1,600 meters. So this light will light up when you pass this auto marker, and the pilot will then know it's only 4 nautical miles to the beginning of the landing strip. Okay, so I already removed a couple of screws. This is the front frame. The light socket here just came off. The cables are so corroded they just snapped off. Then we have the cover here behind. There was a serial number manufacturer plate here, which is barely readable. Maybe a couple of numbers and maybe a couple of letters can be read. I don't know even the manufacturer. Don't know, cannot read it. And the interesting thing here is the entire box here, this entire can, is soldered airtight, watertight, like a tin can. And it has here a strip of maybe copper tape, maybe it's a nickel tape, which is also soldered, and that can be ripped open to open this can here. So I have to figure out. Okay, I can remove that part here, which drives that wheel here, which will change that counter in the top, which is the course indicator. That's the, like on a compass, 360 degrees indicating the direction you actually want to fly. So it depends on, well, I don't know exactly how to set that, but okay, that's the tube for the wires for the lamp. That's the wires down here. So, oh yeah, they can be unsoldered here or just snapped. Okay, that's it. Was a little bit more solder than I expected. And for those who want to criticize me for using the wrong tools, this is a chisel and this is a hammer. So this is absolutely the right way to open things like that up. Believe me. Okay, now it gets funny. Ooh, what do we have here? That's amazing. Okay, so that was the airtight can with the broken window. We have, of course, a big connector, a small connector, some potentiometers to adjust some things, and we have that looks nice. Let's see if we turn that. Yeah, look at this. Why have they done this? So, That's amazing. So they managed it to get all the numbers from 0 to 9 on one single wheel. And then they made this. Okay, this is only one strip that goes from 0 to how much? Needs a bit of magic fluid here, and maybe here, and maybe here, and possibly here. My god, where is that going through? Maybe here. Is that enough? Is it going better? Oh yeah, already a bit better. Magic fluid, oil. Okay, let me adjust the camera a bit. So, let's go backward. Goes from 0 to 35. So we have 35 numbers on this plastic. No, it's not plastic. It's made of metal. Can see it underneath there. It's either stainless steel or aluminium. I think it's more like steel because that's more durable. It is mounted like caterpillar track with two wheels. It has holes in the center to keep the position. There are some teeth here on the wheel that will transport that track, that band, forward. Okay, very interesting. I haven't seen that before. Normally they take just three wheels, but there is one trick. How do you reset to 0 after you reached 35? So you better make one big wheel with 35 numbers that jumps to 0 when it's around for one time. Okay, how funny. Now that's the part for the horizontal needle that indicates if you're too high or too low. So if the needle is underneath the center, you're too low, you have to fly higher. If it's above, you're too high. There is the other needle for left and right. It's just like an analog what do you call voltmeter or analog meter. It's just a moving coil, I think. Yeah, the magnet is fixed, the coil is moving, you apply some voltage and it deflects to one or the other side. They made three bars here that makes it very rigid to either direction, and it's also very light. Then we have another indicator, a red flag here, which is visible when there is no glide slope signal. So if the whole instrument is not working, this is visible. If there is a signal, this gets away like that, indicating that everything is all right. Then you have here an indicator that says nothing or from or to. So that means if you are flying in direction to the airport or if you are coming from the airport. if I think. I think that's like this. I hope so. If not, please correct me in the comments of this video. I'm always able to learn some things. Okay. Well, let's take it further apart. It's amazing what you can do with a hammer. It also works like pliers. It's a multifunctional hammer. Which has this contraption around here, which is, so I think, just a seal to prevent any moisture or whatever dust to get along the axle inside the unit. I think that's the reason why it takes a little bit force to turn that. Certainly an O-ring seal, sort of. It's all soldered together. Will be a little bit difficult to have a look inside. Well, we will see. Funny, that's the adjustment screw for, I don't know which side. It was written here. Blue 0. Need my glasses. I have them on my head, of course. 0, adjust. Localizer, glide slope. Localizer, that's the position left or right. Glide slope is the position lower or higher. You can adjust the 0 point with this screw. And the other one with this screw, and there is this little bent axle here, and this is bent by purpose. I didn't do that because this axle goes between this fork here, and because it is bent, it moves the fork sideways like this, which then in turn will center the needle here. So now it's a little bit off center. Let's see, on the other side we have a same, an identical needle. Oh, it jumps a bit, but we can center that in. So that's it. Of course, for a correct adjustment, you have to connect all the electronic gear that belongs to that, because this is only the indicator. It's not the whole system. The whole system is a big black box somewhere in the belly of the airplane. So that's only the indicator. Like today we would say it's only the screen, the computer is somewhere else, but in those days they had no screens and no computers in the airplanes. That's a synchro control transformer with a one-phase rotor and a three-phase stator. And what this does, I will explain you in the next video. Okay, that's another interesting part. That was the point where this small pointer was attached. It also has a synchro motor behind it, and the whole motor thing can be turned mechanically. So it needs this slip rings here to contact the motor, which is inside this drum, electrically. We have two contacts on this side and two on the other side, and then the contacts go to the two of them go to the rotor, which is inside here in the center, with other spring leaf contacts. And the other two, I think, are the stator, which is outside. I think that's these two wires here, and that will position this needle here to indicate. I have no idea what kind of indicator that is. Maybe the direction you're actually flying, some kind of compass thing. Well, if you want to know all these details, just Google for ILS, instrument landing system. It's still in use, it still works the same way, but you will certainly find an explanation on Wikipedia or whatever nice site you like about all these things. Okay, that's enough for today. We'll see you with my next video. Thanks for watching.